the first Reserve Bank of India board meeting after the appointment of the new governor, Shaktikanta Das, will be held on Friday, tomorrow. The governance of the Reserve Bank and the power of the board will be an important subject of discussion. Secondly, the relaxation, if any, of the prompt corrective action regimen that identifies weak banks is expected to be discussed. Finally, the committee, the board, will also decide on the appropriate capital that Reserve Bank needs. The committee that will decide it is likely to be appointed at the board meeting. Well, to give us a sense of what to expect from the meeting, I have with me an eminent panel, V.G. Kannan's, former Managing Director of State Bank of India and CEO of Indian Banks Association currently, Janmajaya Sinha of BCG, Boston Consulting Group, and R.K. Bakshi, former Executive Director of Bank of Baroda. Gentlemen, welcome. Before I start and invite your opinions, let me ask my correspondent, Ritu Singh, who has been following the matter very closely. She's joined me in the studio. Ritu, this is a continuation of the unfinished November 19th board meeting. Mm. So what were the unfinished decisions that's going to be taken up?
Well, yes, several decisions were taken in the last board meeting. Let me quickly run you through them of what was done and what is left to be done. First was the capital framework of Reserve Bank of India, which has been a contentious issue. In the last board meeting, the board members, which includes members from, of the government body, so to speak, they decided to constitute a committee that would study the capital framework. Now, in this board meeting, it is likely that who will comprise of that committee, which was to be jointly recommended by the government and the RBI. Perhaps the constitution could be decided in the board meeting that is likely to take place. Now, the second item in the last board meeting's agenda was to consider a scheme for restructuring the stressed but standard MSME loans of up to 25 crore rupees. Since the board meeting held on the 19th of November, nothing has been said of what this proposal really will be. So that is something that is likely to be carried forward in the board meeting on December 14th. Third is, there was some relaxation given under the capital framework where the capital conservation buffer, the last tranche of it, which is about 0.625%, that meeting that criteria was extended by a period of 1 year for banks. So they only have to meet that additional 0.6% by 2020 instead of 2019. Mm-hmm. The board had decided to stick with the capital adequacy ratio of 9%, which is 1% higher than the Basel III norms. And lastly, the board had agreed that the Board for Financial Supervision would look into the prompt corrective action norms without saying whether or not there is a need to relax it. So we understand this will be the overarching theme, the relaxation, if any, to the prompt corrective action norms. Do remember there are 11 banks that are currently under the PCA framework. All of these are public sector banks. Some of them, two of them actually, Dena Bank and Allahabad Bank, actually have lending restrictions, and the rest of the banks have restrictions to the extent that they only are allowed to lend to the higher rated corporates. Now there is a possibility, as some of the bankers we've been speaking to that have suggested, perhaps the banks that have been showing an improvement over the last few quarters, some trends where they've shown an improvement in NPAs, in return on assets, perhaps some restrictions could be eased on a select few banks. But overall, we're yet to see what the BFS has recommended and what the board decides to take up. And the other important thing, of course, will be the governance of the board itself, where the government wants the board, the central board, to have a more direct say into the policies that the RBI frames, and that is something we understand could also be taken up in the December 14th board meeting. But Latha, let me come to you on this. The governor has changed. That is the one big change since the last meeting. The last meeting, I know we stood around for 10 hours for it to get over, but this time around, do you expect it to be a little more cordial?
Well, one hopes it is shorter, for one. Well, the most contentious issue, which I thought from the previous meeting, was whether the board should be allowed to dictate to RBI. How accountable is RBI? Because until now it was an advisory board. So here we will just play out to you what the new governor said when he first met the press. He seemed to believe that although RBI is independent, it has to be accountable. So maybe he will give in to the appointment, and maybe he wouldn't have even a choice because that's what the board wants. The second point that he made to us that day was that there are some areas which are not getting credit. So while RBI has a mandate of targeting inflation, it should be in synchronous. It should be along with the objective of growth. After inflation is achieved, the objective of growth should also be kept in mind. And he did make a reference to the fact that some sectors are not getting credit. So he may be amenable to a quick scheme for MSME credit, because that seems to be one big demand. And finally, we will have to see whether anything on PCA itself comes. Actually, let's listen to the governor on what he said about the board governance, and then we are going to our guests.
I would not like to go into what were the issues or what are the issues between government, which is an important, which runs the country, and the Reserve Bank of India. But every institution, every institution has to have its professional integrity, maintain its professional autonomy. At the same time, every institution also must adhere to principles of accountability.
Okay, every institution should also be accountable, or is amenable to principles of accountability. Well, with that, let's go across to our guests, Janmajaya Sinha, R.K. Bakshi, and V.G. Kannan with us. Mr. Sinha, first to you. One always thought of the RBI board as advisory. Very powerful. There have been, the scientist Abdul Kalam was a member of the board. Narayan Murthy was a member of the board. Ratan Tata was a member of the board. It has had very powerful people, but it was always advisory. Now the RBI is being made accountable to the board. Do you think that's the way to go?
Look, I mean, to be honest with you, I don't know what these terms mean. You know, every board, every organization has to be accountable. Every board has a certain function, and that is the function that is there. You know, I mean, I think these terms are being brought in, whether it's advisory or whether it's a real board. Every board in the world has to ensure a set of things. And they need to have a discussion, and then the management has to go and execute those things, because the board cannot execute those things. They are independent directors on the board. How much time do they have? How much can they get into the nitty-gritty? The big issues are brought in as a counsel to the executive, and then they are after that deliberated and executed by the executive. So I don't know. You know, I mean, I think these terms are being given more meaning than there is. Every institution has to be
Mr. Sinha.
Every institution
I did
has
not
to,
give...
I
mean, so. We haven't given it meaning. It was Vyach Maligam who spoke to us, and he's 21 years member of the RBI board, the longest serving board member. And his point was that this is not like any other board. This is the central bank's board. It is meant to be a representative of society, which is why you have even social workers and scientists. And the important point is this board does not appoint its CEO or its COO. The CEO and the COO are appointed by the government. And this is a board which is supposed to be a representative of society and a sounding board for advice to the Reserve Bank. So it's technically different from any other board.
Yeah, but look, all public sector banks, are the chairmans appointed by the board? They are not. All state-owned enterprises, that's the same thing. So I'm just saying, look, we can understand there is a certain governance structure, and across ownership forms, it does vary. And the fact is, it is very important for the views of society, civil society, to be aired and, you know, discussed in a board. But after that, the executive, you know, how does a board inspect a bank? I mean, how does a board actually, you know, these are technical issues. How much time do board members have? You know, I mean, some of these board members run the biggest conglomerates in India. You know, they must be spending 6-8 days a year. How much time, you know, you when you are an independent member, then you are independent and you don't have, you know, the executive time. So we just need to be realistic. I mean, you know, every organization should listen to their board with great deal of respect and interest. But after that, the board also has to know what it can't do. It just cannot run the place. They are independent directors on the board.
Okay. Well, one hopes so. You know, in other countries, for instance, the Fed chairman is answerable to the Senate. The RBI governor also.
That's a very different thing.
Yeah.
Let's take the Federal Reserve.
It's not answerable to its board.
The Federal Reserve is a very different structure. Yeah, because and also the board has only got other governors. Know, on that Federal Reserve Board. So it's a very different, so it's got a very different structure. And so, I mean, and they are set up with different purpose. You are exactly right when you said, you know, you have all types of people who are on the board so that India's civil society can have expression. Indian industrialists can have expression. The government can have expression. And that's exactly right. You know, I mean, because it is a bank which has to manage inflation, it has to manage currency, it has to manage the banking system. So there are a lot of responsibilities.
Okay, it's quite possible what you say happens or what Mr. Shaktikanta Das indicated happens. He said RBI has to be accountable. All institutions have to be amenable to the principle of accountability. So maybe they'll appoint the committees. But as Mr. Sinha says, effectively, the board, since they have other full-time jobs, can at best oversee or question once in a way. It will not be a minute overseeing. But I think we should move to the most important question of PCA.
I suppose, yes, and we also have Mr. Kannan with us. I'll ask him this. You know, Mr. Kannan, there is a lot of expectation that the board will do something for the banks under PCA. What are the options before RBI? It can't be a, you know, blanket relaxation for all banks, can it?
See, that could be, as of now, they have been directed that they should reduce the risk, risk assets. Therefore, in the SME or for that matter, corporate assets, they cannot take up anything other than AAA or AA. And some banks like Dena Bank and I think a couple of banks have been told not to lend at all. So that could be some relaxation saying that you can lend to, say, maybe retail or small-scale industries of a particular size. So there's some activity going on, one. Second thing is that could also be a scenario where they have made some recoveries and the health has relatively improved. I'm not saying improved completely. They could be given some relaxation so that, you know, they can at least increase the balance sheet size and earn something rather than putting everything into G-Sec, which is safe, of course, but at the same time doesn't yield, give you the necessary yield. They need to also get into the habit of making money out of assets rather than only from lazy banking G-Sec. So some relaxation there could be considered, which could ensure that the field people also become activated in lending operations.
Okay, actually, it's not that they can't lend. I think they can lend to A and above companies.
Correct. Yeah,
two of them can't. Right?
Yeah, only Dena and Allahabad Bank are completely restricted from the lending. For the rest of the weak banks, they're only allowed to lend to the higher rated corporates. This is in the interest of the banks, again, to improve their financial position. So
and
they
should remember, you know, how weak they are. The data will run by.
Yeah.
You know, if the capital adequacy falls 250 basis points below the asking rate, which is 10.25, counting all kinds of capital, and if they are loss-making for 2 years, that is negative ROA for two consecutive years, and their net NPA, gross NPA can be anything, but net NPA is above 6%, which means for 6% of the loans which have gone bad, they have not provided, only then they are put under PCA. Yeah. So it's not a very low filter, it's quite a high bar, and even then we have 11 banks. Actually, on that point, let me come to you, Mr. Bakshi. You know, if these are the high bars, 2 years of loss-making, and 6% net NPA. Most of these guys have gross NPA in double digits. Is the RBI making a very serious demand?
No, the PCA yardsticks are not incorrect or bad. But let us reconcile to the fact that 2 years of losses at the net level do not mean that they are operating losses also. So they may be having an operating profit. Why the losses are coming? Because of the NPAs and NPAs aging, the provision requirements have become progressively very high. Whether they are cases referred to NCLT, where the provisions had to be raised almost to 100%, or in doubtful categories, the provisions had to be raised to a very substantial increase. So provision coverage ratios of the banks have been increasing. Does it really point out, I'm not saying for a moment that the lending restriction should be relaxed. That is not the point right now. But the point is to put things in perspective. If the banks are not expanding their books, Suppose you say that they cannot lend to anybody below A. In fact, we have got too many A-rated clients in the country who will flock to these banks and who do not have other bankers who are already dealing with them. Even a choice, a higher-rated customer will like to deal with a bank which is not in PCA, which has got adequate capital, and which can help them to a larger extent. Rather than why will they seek a long thing? And how many A-rated clients are there?
Mr. Sinha,
I'm not even putting a question.
Well, we take your point, Mr. Bakshi. Mr. Sinha, we'll come to you on this as well. Do you think the current PCA regime is too harsh? And second, do you really think, you know, as the government officials have been telling us, is it really restrictive of credit flow in the economy? I mean, the last number we saw was some 15.6% credit growth. Do you really think there is a need to relax PCA to ease credit flow in the system, which is the argument that the government has been taking?
Look, you know, to be very honest with you, what is this discussion? This discussion is about capital. It's not really about PCA. If banks were properly capitalized, everyone wants them to lend in the market. That's how they will make money. And so it's important that they have the requisite cushion so that their depositors are not at risk. Because one way or the other, if any of these banks fail, which are government-owned, the government will have to pay for it. Either it will give them capital or it will have to bail out the depositors. So I don't think there is this particular, you know, I mean, some of these issues have just become contentious without real purpose. How much is Dena Bank and Bank of Maharashtra as a share, market share of banking in India? What, 1.5%, something like that? Yeah. I mean, really small amounts, you know, I mean, and how much are they in credit? Again, very small. So, you know, how much of an impact is Bank of Maharashtra and Dena Bank having on credit growth in the country? Is this State Bank? If State Bank was in this type of a situation, we would have a problem, right? I mean, the banking system would collapse. But when you're taking really small banks, you know, the question is, how do you strengthen them and how do you capitalize them? Now, this story and this scenario is what is getting, what is under focus. It is also true that as banks' balance sheets grow, their bad loans become a smaller percentage of their balance sheet, which makes it easier to get out of a debt problem. But you then have to lend to better borrowers.
Yes.
Meaning, if you lend to worse borrowers, then you create a worse situation.
That's the
point.
So
you have to just keep that balance. You know, so that's what I'm saying. You know, so I mean, we have to just recognize
what is
the logic of this.
No, then you're probably indirectly saying that what the Reserve Bank said was right after all. If you capitalized, we would never have put them in this category. And secondly, and this is the question I'll come to you after the break, come to all of you after the break. The whole point, apparently, of the Reserve Bank is that if they are led out of PCA, chances are that under the current circumstances, with a lot of NBFCs hawking their riskier loans, these banks could get into further trouble, either because of political pressure or perceived pressure. And that is exactly what the Reserve Bank wants to avoid, that the NBFC problem doesn't become a PSU bank problem. That question to all of you after the break in a minute.